Presenting your initial idea or later more refined versions of your offering can deliver key learnings. What is the experience from our tech entrepreneurs? 4TU technology entrepreneurs address various aspects of the value of building MVPs.
I started in the airport market. So when I made this sketch of a machine that could just take up all the snow from one runway, I thought, okay, I've made now the sketch. I think it's a good idea, but the market should confirm if the idea is good, yes or no. So I approached Amsterdam Airport Schiphol and I asked them, how do you feel about this sketch and would this help you? And they said, well, never heard of snow compression before. So that's interesting. But did you consider of how about getting this machine on and off the runway? How do you see some guys steering this machine and all these practical challenges that airports face in order to make this machine work, yes or no? When I presented this sketch to the Amsterdam Airport Schiphol, I was showing a technology compressing snow, but I was also showing a product, and it was a very simple sketch, and the product was for runways. And the feedback they gave me was that the technology was good, but the product I envisioned for the runways was shit. So they basically told me, how about thinking about using this technology for another part of our airport, for example, the gate area, where as a passenger you get in and out. So that basically made me shift my focus more to like where the problem is the biggest. And that feedback determined a lot. It shaped my product.
I think every engineer should fake it before they even build a product. So first you do the numbers and then you build a fake product and then you build a prototype. I think that's the best way, because what you see is a lot of engineers building a prototype first, not knowing how big the business is, not knowing if they're even customers. So all the time you put in the prototype, it's just a waste of time. If nobody wants your prototype, it's a waste of time. Just start with a PowerPoint maybe. And then what we do is, so you often hear engineers like talking about, okay, we've built the best code, we've built so many tests, and now it's a feature that nobody uses and everybody throws it away. So you spend so much time in building great code, and in the end it's just like thrown away with the rest, or if the company doesn't work, it's thrown away. And so what we've done like early on in the company is build a culture where you first build like a really tiny version of a feature. And we have like, so it's not really common in security to have this. So it's like a tiny feature that's unstable, and then we look if people are using this functionality. And so like it can be really small, like creating hacker profiles was one of them. And so people say, okay, this is really interesting, but they interacted in a very different way with our hacker profiles that we've created. And now we are spending like several weeks to optimize this functionality and get it actually in the product as a stable feature. And so continuously we're doing features in this way. And the other thing is like sometimes you have to do a feature, but there'll only be a paying customer like in 6 months. So okay, just like plan it in that you do it with 5 months from now, build it in 1 month, and then it will be ready when you sell it to the customer. So it's so important to focus on like keeping lean, not doing enough, so you can have time to like sleep. You should think of it like that.
The tools is really by interviewing people. We go to the hospital and we make models of the product. It's made of out of foam, and we hand this to the end user and we ask them, where would you put our product? And then they look around and they place it in the corner of their ultrasound room. And then we check, okay, where is the power socket? And that means we know how long the cable should be. But also we check, where is the refrigerator? Because our conversations will be stored in the refrigerator. So that gives us a lot of information, how our product should look like.
What we're doing now is we're using Wi-Fi, 4G, GSM signals, so existing communication signals as a power source. But initially we built our own box that was sending out radio frequency signals. As it turns out, that disturbs existing signals a lot. So there's a ton of regulation problems there. And that's something you just cannot change. So there was a time where we were thinking, well, this road is a bit of a dead end, because we're never going to be able to put these boxes sending out these signals everywhere, because it's disturbing what's already there. But then we made the transition saying, well, these boxes already exist. We simply call them Wi-Fi routers right now, or a telecom tower. So then we pivoted to that. But initially, we're kind of on a dead track there.
Yeah. My most critical point during the last years was when I engineered and built my second prototype. And we took this second prototype to the Finnish Arctic Circle close to the Russian border. Well, and the idea was that it would snow there so often that you could always test your prototype and demonstrate it to my potential customer. But it was in the wind. I was there for 2 months in February and March, and it just didn't snow. Not a single snowflake. And I went there specifically because even if it doesn't snow, it's always so cold over there that you can just drive over the lakes and use the old snow, which is like from a month old. But it was also that warm that the ice was 40 centimeters thick, and I needed 50 centimeters in order to drive safely over the lakes. So there was no snow, I couldn't drive over the lakes, and I was on the Arctic Circle near the Russian border. So, and I had my prototype was built in such a way that it took a long time to build everything together and make it ready for testing purposes. So I was on a very remote area, I was not flexible, and my funding was only until the end of that testing period, like until April. So I didn't achieve my goals, I was not flexible, I had no money, and at the end of the winter I just decided to ship everything back in a container without reaching the goals. Because I didn't want to go bankrupt on the Finnish Arctic Circle near the Russian border. So what I learned from this was that if you have like a budget to reach your goals, always think about what might happen that could be like a serious jeopardy for reaching the goals. And make your plan in such a way that whatever happens, you always can think of a solution to reach that goal. And that basically contains the whole spectrum. So your funding, your prototype, your customer, because Amsterdam Airport Schiphol would come to the Arctic Circle to see your working prototype. Yeah. And they would need to travel for 2 days, one journey, and so 4 days there and back again, to visit this prototype, which was not the best location at the first place to have a demo. All these things together made me realize that my next prototype versions, I need to process all these experiences in order to be more flexible and combine like market funding, but also like how I engineered my prototype was better organized.
So we have exactly that, basically a demo showing what it's doing. But more important than that, I think, is just the business case. So what's most convincing for them is to see how this is going to save them money, how this is going to be better than what they're doing right now. And they want to see some sort of proof of principle that what we're saying actually works and makes sense. But I think the business case you present next to that is actually the most convincing part of it.
Our focus has always been on bringing this product to the clinical market. And to bring it to the clinical market, you have to demonstrate that your product is safe, that there is a clear medical need, and that you can actually make better ultrasound images. So to get there, you need data. You need people that validate your system, that have used your system and have proven that your product really is superior to other products in the field. So by having this system available, third parties can gather the data and they share it with us. So it actually helps us to get the data so that we can go from the preclinical market to the clinical market.
When you succeed in making your first customers enthusiastic about your offering, you can often use this as a springboard for the development of your venture. What is the experience from our tech entrepreneurs? 4TU technology entrepreneurs address various aspects of the value of building MVPs.
The feedback from the market about whether your idea is good, yes or no, is like the most important thing you can get if you like engineer or invent something. Because that will tell you if you're doing a good job, yes or no, which is from a personal perspective, always good to know if you're doing something good, yes or no. But it will also guide you in order to make your product and your company better. So getting feedback from customers, which I got from the very first part when I present the sketch to Amsterdam Airport Schiphol, it's vital. So if you make your first sketch, go to the market straight away, get feedback, and if that's positive, file a patent.
For us, one of the key ways, so again, what we did to fund ourselves in the very first phases, we're doing these pilot projects where we say, well, we built these initial prototypes and we want to do some tests with different companies to see how it acts and how it behaves. And these were very rough initial prototypes, so they're not good at all, and they're not actually providing a lot of value to the company when they're testing it, because they're too early stage for that. But the fact that in some industries we saw that companies were really willing to pay for even a really rough first prototype, they were only doing that because they could see where it's heading, and that would actually be really useful for them. So it was also a way for us to test where's the traction in this.
After you've given a first successful demonstration or a first use at a customer, then that is always like a bridge to like the next successful demonstration or the next customer. So always make sure that you give your customer at during a demonstration or use at his or her airport like the best attention you can give, and that will lead you to the next one. And if you see that that's going to happen, you know that you need to make more products, you need to have more people in order to get this done. So paying a lot of attention to your customer will basically already tell you what's going to happen afterwards and how you need to tackle the challenges that comes with it.
The most critical moments during this development of this product was to how to bring this product to the medical field. So we are talking here about a medical product. So it's not so easy to bring that to the market. It takes a lot of time and a lot of investment. So we had to find the right route. And we identified a route where we first develop a product to the research and preclinical market. And this was actually quite a big decision because it required a lot of investment. We had to build a product that is suitable to sell to our customers. And of course, we had limited resources at the time. So it was a tough decision. But because we had such good responses from people that we have been talking to, we decided to make this step and we developed our product. And actually, it worked out really well. So we were able to sell our first products already in a very early phase. So we could actually sell our products before we had developed them. So this meant we had paying customers. We had very positive feedback. So that actually ended up in this product. And this product is now being used by researchers, mostly in Europe, also in America. And these researchers are now our ambassadors. So at the time, it was a tough decision to make it, because we thought, how can we ever get to the medical market? But now we see that our first customers are our ambassadors, and that this helps to accelerate to bring this to the medical field.
This is kind of a sales funnel, basically, but we initially have some sort of first interviews or conversations with them. And then normally there would be a feasibility study where we see, is this even feasible? Is it realistic that we could do this in your use cases, in your business? And then the next step is some sort of test or pilot project where we actually show in practice that this is working and it's benefiting them. And then the final step would be that they can actually deploy it.